This is a three-part video series that is focusing on how to become a good YouTuber. Emphasis on the good part, less so on not only how to make YouTube videos, but how to be good at doing it and how to be a good person doing it as well. The first part of this video series has been released already, so if you have missed it, then link in the description box below to find the playlist of this video series. This episode will focus more on about creating content, giving real examples, real talks, and I have to stress that this isn't about how to gain subscribers or gain viewers, it's more about how to be a good content creator. I'll show things that I've done in the past so you can learn from my mistakes and learn from the stuff that I did correctly. I want to say a huge, great big thank you to Patreon and the Patreon supporters. If you are a Patreon supporter of $7 or more, please check out on Monday for your podcasts. And also a big thank you to the members as well. I would not be able to make YouTube videos if it wasn't for the help that you give me. Work, life, YouTube balance. It is an important factor when you are being a YouTuber. It's very difficult to get it right. Seriously, very difficult. As I mentioned briefly in the last video, you're gonna have to spend a lot of time building up your YouTube channel to the place that you want it to be. Very few of us work like machines, like workhorses, including myself. We need a balance. You may have a job, you may have education, you may have friends or family that need seeing. It may be very difficult to get all of that stuff done effectively. And not to mention, you also need time for yourself just to be alone and think nothing. And getting this balance is very difficult. The best advice I can give you is twofold. First of all, allocate yourself time. And second of all, be consistent. If you're a person who has a full-time job, this may be very difficult to start a YouTube channel. When I had a full-time job, I used to make videos on the way to work, and then I'd make videos on the way back from work as well, and edit them at the end of the day. And then I'd have 2 days worth of content made in a single day. I did this for a long, long time, but that might be difficult depending on the type of content that you're making. For example, if you're focusing on video games, then you can't walk to work and play video games at the same time, unless it's Pokemon Go, mind blown. But for me, it worked out very well, because I was focusing on subject knowledge and field of expertise. And I didn't need to research the stuff I was talking about because I already know the stuff I was talking about. I just needed to say it. So it's kind of like a half vlog, half educational video. And that worked out very well. Now, there are other things that you can do to allocate yourself time. For example, after you finish work, you can go home and then start your video making process. If that's writing a script or recording or editing, whatever it is, that is something you can do. So when you get home at night, before you shut down your system and just fully relax after a day's work, do your YouTube work. If you create a pattern, then it gives yourself a habit. And when you make a habit, you will find it a lot easier to create good content, because making a habit means that you are doing something that you do rather than doing something that you have to do, if that makes sense. Other people may find it easier to wake up earlier than they need to and start their day 2 hours beforehand. There's a lot of recommendations on YouTube about waking up at 4 or 5 in the morning, getting a few hours of work in, and then starting your day. And then at night, you just go to sleep earlier, because the time that you spend at night is usually wasted. You're either watching TV, it's very unproductive, you're on your phone, disrupting your sleep pattern. If you just wake up earlier, you'll go to sleep earlier and waste that unproductive moments at night. However, depending on your specific living circumstances, this might not be doable for you. Either way, you have to allocate yourself some time at some point. You just need to do it. If your friend phones you up and they're like, oh, Giz, can you just do this when you get in? You have to say, I'm afraid I have to do something before I can do that. Don't say, no, I can't do it. Just say, I have to get something done before I can do this. Sometimes people have asked me if I wanted to do something. It's usually Chez, and he usually says, do you want to come over and play Worms Armageddon? And I'm like, I've got to do some editing, but I'll come over after. That's what you need to do. School students, if you're a student and you're looking to get into YouTube and doing YouTube full time, listen to my advice. A lot of new YouTubers and YouTube content creators are students still. And the problem that I find is that a lot of them will slack off their education in order to create content. Don't do this at all. Do not slack off your education. You need to know how to add, you need to know how to read and write, you need to know the structure of an atom, you need to know basic second language skills. you need education. Believe it or not, you need to know how to find the value of X on a right-angled triangle. Education in schools isn't about the subject themselves, it's about the skills that they provide you in order to achieve the answer of the goal. For example, math isn't about maths. Maths is about giving you problem-solving skills. The idea of finding the value of X isn't about the actual number. They don't care about that. They just want you to know the skills involved into finding out that circumstance so you can transfer that to something else. When it comes to English or language, it isn't about grammar or capitalizations that they care about. It's being able to effectively and efficiently communicate to someone else. Science isn't about elements and chemicals. It's about understanding the processes of something that you cannot see for yourself. Education is important. Do not do YouTube instead of school. Do YouTube as well as school. And for those of you who say, well, Bill Gates dropped out of school or Casey Neistat dropped out of school, do you think for a second they just stopped their education just because they weren't in school? It wasn't the education that was the problem. It was the value of the school system itself that was the issue. There's a huge difference. What was I talking about? The second piece of advice is to be consistent. If you get up at 5 o'clock every single morning and you have 2 hours of work to do before your day begins, make sure it's consistent. Like I said, make it a habit. And it seems less like something you have to do and something that you just do, if that makes sense. And now we're going to move on to doing videos themselves. Making content. Once you have a plan, just do it. A half-baked plan executed half well is better than a perfect plan not executed at all. Do it. Once you've started making content, it can be overwhelming at first, but keep your head cool. The great thing about YouTube and YouTube videos is that the feedback you get from your audience is instantaneous. If you press publish, you get feedback straight away. But you have to make sure that you're consistent. Tell the audience that you're posting every Wednesday and stick to it. On top of that, tell them what time you publish. 7:30 every single morning. Stick to it. Learn from my mistakes. I've been around for over 11 years on YouTube, and in that 11 years time, I've taken some of the biggest breaks known to man. And during that time of being away from YouTube with those breaks, it makes me seem very inconsistent and very unreliable when it comes to content creation. And people are less likely to stick around because of that. If I'd have stuck to a content plan like I have now, back in 2007, I'd be a huge YouTuber right now. As I mentioned, it's good to post videos on the same time each morning because people do wait for your videos. You will be surprised how much support you get from just random people you don't know. The audience. This can be very difficult for people to hear, but your subscribers are everything to your YouTube channel, and they're also nothing at the same time. Your subscribers will only stick around if you are a good content creator, and communication is everything. I'm not a fan of content creators who say that they love their fans, because how the hell can you? If you say, guys, I'd be lost without you, I love you all, thank you very much. Like, how can you love me? Like, you don't know me. You can appreciate them all you like, but love? No, you don't love your audience. Which is where communication really comes into play. Because when you're small, you need to take care of the subscribers that you've got. Every single subscriber that you have is someone saying, I enjoy you and I enjoy your content, I'm coming back for more. And you need to show your appreciation for that. So communication is very important. Respond to the comments, like the comments, pin the comments if it's necessary, and love the comments if you really love a comment. And when you get bigger and bigger each week, say you're gaining hundreds of subscribers every single week, I don't know, you might do. It can be very difficult to stay in touch with all the subscribers that you do have and all the subscribers that have been there since the beginning. It can be difficult to make a real connection, which is why it's still important to respond to the comments when you can, pin them, like them, love them if you do love them. You might get to the point where you need to create a platform for those true diehard fans, and this is where things like Twitter or Discord really come into their own element. This way you'll have two groups of diehard fans, your subscribers and the true diehards, in two separate places. Which means if someone really wants to passionately follow you, they can and they have the option. As a subscriber, this goes out to everyone. You have a duty to tell the content creator when they're doing something stupid. Positive feedback is great, but negative feedback is important. You learn from mistakes, you don't learn from your positives. Any good manager for a shop will say that if you look after the staff, then the staff will look after the customers. And this is so true. If you take care of your subscribers will take care of you, no problem. But let's fast forward a little bit. Let's say that you've been making content for a little while and it's been, say, 6 months and you've got a small subscriber base, a small loyalty base of a couple thousand, let's just say. I don't know exactly the metrics. But what do you do next? Is it more content? Do you post out more content? Well, you should only post out more content if that is the type of content you post. Can you post out more content? If you found your groove in the content creation process and you're communicating effectively to your subscribers, maybe the next level is more content, or maybe it's different content. For example, say you're a gamer and you make videos playing Minecraft, why don't you switch up games and go to Destiny or Pokemon? Stick to your genre, but just mix it up a little bit. When you start mixing up content, you attract a different audience that will be attracted to you as a person and not necessarily the content that you create. As long as you remain consistent in both your upload schedule and the character that you portray on your videos, then people will stick around to that type of content. The next step could be you're thinking about collaborations with other YouTubers. And here's the biggest bit of advice. To be a good YouTuber, don't focus on the subscriber count of the collaboratee. If you enjoy them and you enjoy their content, then collaborate with them. If you have 1,000 subscribers and they only have 100, don't worry about the numbers. Just collaborate if you like what they do, because your subscribers will more likely watch your videos if you are having fun with the videos that you're making. If this means that you don't get a lot of subscribers out of it in the long run, then so be it. That person that you collaborate with in the long run may be more successful than you, and they'll always remember the creator that gave them their big break, and that's worth it, I think. Partnerships. Okay, this is a big one. You've gained 1,000 plus subscribers, now you're thinking about joining the YouTube partnership program. As long as you are making good, consistent content, you may adhere to the criteria of being a YouTube partner. Currently, you need 1,000 subscribers and 4,000 hours of watch time over the course of a single year. You also need a good standing in the community, which means no copyright strikes or strikes in general. And if you do adhere to the criteria, then just apply, because the application process of becoming a YouTube partner apparently is quite big and quite long, so it may take a while for you to get approved as a YouTube partner. I strongly advise you sticking to YouTube partnership rather than going to a multi-channel network. I'm not going to get into why I think that. There's lots of other videos on YouTube that will explain the pros and cons of being in an MCN. But I wish that I'd never done it before in my life, because I feel like I got cheated for money and value. Social media. If you're releasing a piece of content, then you're going to need to post it on all the social media things that you have. Either if you're doing a live stream or you're doing a video, then you need to post it in places. There's two reasons because of this. First of all, people aren't always on YouTube. They're on other types of social media as well. So if you post, hey, I'm doing a video now, go and watch it, then people will go to that video because they need to know when it's on. And the second reason is the sub box is broken and we all know it. Not getting big-headed. There may come a time where you're starting to gain some traction. Maybe you've got a big subscriber count. Maybe you're making some good money, or maybe you're getting noticed in public. Either way, chill out. Nobody likes a rice gun. Nobody likes people who shows off their money or their subscriber count, and people don't like arrogancy because it's unattractive. Just be respectful and kind and dignified. Just be an okay person. If someone recognizes you in the street, which has happened to me before, be kind. Explain to them that you don't have any time. Say it was nice to meet them, but you have to be somewhere right now. Don't be a diva. Don't be all like, don't talk to me, don't tell me your name. If you do have time for them, then make time for them. Say hello, get to know them, say thank you for subscribing or whatever, and then leave. I once got noticed in my hometown by a guy and his girlfriend for making YouTube videos. Well, mainly him, not her. But still. And he wanted to talk to me more about lucid dreaming, and he asked if I was free anytime. And I went, yeah, I'm free tomorrow. Let's do it. So I met up with him the day after, and we had a nice walk, got some food, went home. I didn't take him to my house. But yeah, we just had a chat about YouTube and lucid dreaming and stuff, and it was quite nice. He's going to remember that for the rest of his life. If you do have time for them, get to know them, talk to them. Learn their name, take a photo with them, because they are your fan base and they are important. So that's it for the second part of this three-part series. If you missed the first part, please check the description box below for the link to the playlist. Being a good YouTuber is quite important for me. It's important for the platform, and I want to say thank you to the supporters who have shown me support over the last few years. The kindness. So thank you to the Patreon supporters and also the YouTube members as well. Remember, if you're a Patreon supporter of $7 or more, then you have your first exclusive podcast on Monday. So until tomorrow with tomorrow's video, bye.